It's my great pleasure to introduce Professor Laurence Zitvogel as our first inaugural Regine Capella Adler Lecture. We just heard about the remarkable life and achievements of this remarkable woman and the importance of this lecture for our university. So it may not come as a surprise that quite a lot of thoughts and scrutiny went into the process identifying an outstanding personality who would give this first inaugural lecture. And we are very grateful that Professor Zitvogel has accepted our invitation. In her, we have really found the person of high standards we were looking for. Professor Zitvogel is a world-renowned pioneer in the field of oncology, immunology, immuno-oncology, as we heard, and immunotherapy. She received her medical and scientific education in Paris and at the Pittsburgh Cancer Center, where she spent 3 years. She holds an MD in clinical oncology and PhD in tumor immunology, and she is a full professor in immunology and clinical biology at the University of Paris Saclay. She's also director of an INSERM research institute of tumor immunology and immunotherapy of cancer, and the director of the Center for Clinical Investigation in Biotherapies of Cancer for novel therapeutic approaches in immune oncology at the Gustave Roussy Cancer Center, the largest and leading cancer center in Europe. We are all aware of the Newsweek ranking, and Roussy is number 3 worldwide and 1 in Europe. Just for your information, the General Hospital of Vienna is number 25, so a little bit behind. She, in addition to her comprehensive research activities, she's also a practicing clinical oncologist, mainly in the field of breast cancer. Professor Zitvogel has published more than 540 PubMed-listed papers with an incredible age index of above 150, many of them in the highest-ranked journals of our field, Science, Cell, Nature Immunology, Nature Medicine, a sheer uncountable number, JCI, JXMed, I think you get the picture. And it may not come as a surprise that her name has been on the Clarivate list of highly cited researchers every year since 2016. Professor Zitvogel is also a dedicated mentor and educator. She has mentored 28 graduate students and 39 postdoctoral fellows. She's an active member of several scientific associations and editorial boards with senior functions in top journals such as Cancer Research, and the recipient of many national international awards, too many to list them all. Perhaps I mentioned the Bailly-Latour Health Prize from Belgium. She received that together with her husband, Guido Krömer, who is also here, and the Leopold Griffel Award, which is the most important award in the field of cancer research. She's a full member of the French National Academy of Medicine and also Chevalier Ordre de la Légion d'Honneur, which she was upgraded in 2019. At the Institut Roussy, Professor Zitvogel has established a remarkable and highly recognized research program in tumor immunology and immunotherapy. Her research accomplishments have pioneered our concepts in oncology and treatment of cancer, mainly in the field of cancer immunotherapy. Her stellar career actually started with the discovery of the immunogenicity of dendritic cells and their exosomes. This also has resulted in clinical trials on dendritic cell-derived exosomes as a therapy for malignant melanoma and lung cancer. And she also made major contributions to the role of NK cells infiltrating tumors and determining the prognosis in NK cell controlled malignancy. She pioneered the concept in immunogenic cell death in cancer therapy, showing that anti-cancer therapy such as radiotherapy, chemotherapy, and also tyrosine kinase inhibitors actually mediate their effect, at least in part, by the help of the immune system reacting to dead cell components. And I think it's fair to say that these discoveries have really paved the path to the success of immune checkpoint inhibitors in the immuno-oncology. Her recent research is focusing on uncovering the role of gut microbiota in cancer immunotherapy, and this will also be the topic of today's lecture. She has really contributed landmark papers showing that chemotherapy, but perhaps more importantly, immunotherapy, lacks efficacy in mice which were raised in a germ-free condition or treated with antibiotics. And importantly, her concept also revealed that modifying gut microbiota may alter the response to immunotherapy. This has resulted in worldwide recommendations to avoid a prophylactic antibiotic in cancer therapy, and also new concepts such as microbiota-specific interventions. I think we all know the fecal microbiota transfer studies, for example, to restore the response to immunotherapy in malignant melanoma. Finally, she also described diagnostic tools, how studying the microbiota may actually predict the response to cancer immunotherapy. And more recently, I also found very interesting concepts on science-driven nutritional interventions modifying the response to cancer immunotherapy, which of course also comes down to a certain degree to gut microbiota. So it's a particular pleasure. We are all excited, Professor Zitvogel, to hear your lecture on the impact of intestinal microbiota on cancer immunotherapy. Dear friends and colleagues, please give us a round of applause and very welcome to our first inaugural Regine Capella Adler lecturer.
For you, it's a little bit music from France, Jacques Offenbach, please.
Thank you very much.
President and Rector of the University Medical School of Vienne, dear Professor Trauner, dear Professor Elbich, dear Liselott, dear Dr. Adler Kastner, dear ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon and thank you very much for this honor. I'm really moved and I feel extremely grateful for this absolute invitation to sit here among all of you, and also beyond the fresque of Hippocrates and Galenus. I think this 250-year-old building is really reflecting how much research, science counts at the level of the society and at the level of the history. So I am very grateful also to the association for the promotion of science and research for selecting me as the very first lecturer to commemorate Regine Kepler Alder scientific achievement. Of course, science takes a lot of personal life, takes a lot of tenacity and resilience and creativity, and those are qualities that are shared among females and males across ages and across origins. So today I'm going to go through my own journey, trying to tell you why I got interested in the demonstrating the impact of the gut microbiota in cancer immunosurveillance. So my thoughts are first going to my patients, trained as an oncologist. I do not remember the patients I try to help, but I do remember very well the one that I couldn't help. And of course, my institution, my French institution, basically located at the southeast of Paris, INSERM, Institut Gustave Roussy, and Paris-Saclay were extremely supportive to me. My thoughts and this distinction is shared, of course, with all my alumni, my PhD students, my postdocs that strove very hard. Their tedious work was amazing, and I admire their relentless race against competitors. I also remember my first steps at the University of Pittsburgh. I was trained by Michael Lotz in the tracks of the very famous Rosenberg, who launched the first steps of cell therapy in cancer. And my thoughts are also going to my dearest Hal Steinmann, a Nobel laureate in 2011. He discovered the dendritic cell-based immune stimulatory and tolerant pathways. Also, I have to fight with my first mentor, Dr. Wolf Hermann Friedman in Paris during my master. It was a very educational training. Fighting against the first mentor is something that you never forget. And also, I am extremely indebted to the tumor immunologist chauvinist in Europe that helped me, together with Guido, to write these guidelines of oncoimmunology earlier on when nobody was believing in cancer immunotherapy. Of course, I have to say thank you to my son, Ulysse, who is not there. Ulysse has forgave me for my work alcoholism, but it didn't discourage him from going ahead and embracing the same career. Now he's in the second year of at the University Medical School of Paris, and he would like to become a neuropsychiatrist. Last but not least, my husband, Guido Krömer. I thank him very cheerfully for his constant support. His relentless discussions and arguments, and also for his remarkable pursuit of excellence and rigor in thinking, writing, and performing research. He is a model, and he will always be a role model for me. So, of course, there is always a dark face, or let's say the contralateral face of the Janus face of being together with a bright scientist like your husband, because what's going on at some point is that you collaborate, you make discoveries, you publish the discoveries together, and what happened at some point is that when you ask for your own grants, you are not allocated your research money by the European Council because you are suddenly interpreted as being completely dependent on your husband. So that's what happened to me. And seven times in a row, I was refused and denied my research allocation. At that time, I was working on immunogenic cell death with Guido, even though I had established my own lab prior to meeting with Guido and collaborating with him. I was, despite this independence, I was definitely rejected by the system. So instead of fighting, I decided to recreate myself, and it saved my life, actually, because when you try to launch a new field, it's extremely difficult. You have to reinvent your tools, you have to reinvent the models, you have to find your collaborators, and everything has to be reinvented from scratch. You have to create something new, because otherwise you will be accused not to invent anything. And so that's what we tried. And I have to acknowledge that France was a cradle of the microbiology with Pasteur and Metchnikov at the Institut Pasteur, and with these big brains like Didier Raoult and the expert in the metagenomics and bioinformatics and experts in the microbial ecosystem. So the Duško Erlich was one of the first to describe the commensalism in humans. I was really benefiting from the soil that allowed me to get the inspiration and the technical help. And so, as you can see, the field flared up exponentially over the last decade. And now, in this bibliometric analysis that has been put together by the Chinese colleagues, we are recognized as the pioneers in this field, and I'm going to share with you what we have been able to demonstrate. Actually, I was also very moved when the famous magazine Nature decided to nominate the importance and the relevance, the clinical significance of the gut commensalism for immuno-oncology. And this was very rapidly followed up by Hanahan, who included the polymorphic bacteria within the hallmarks of cancer. So of course you do not succeed alone. So not only you need the good soil, but you also need contemporaries that will somehow, together with you, share your views, share the reagents, expedite the dissemination of the discoveries. And these wonderful individuals across the world, we are just a handful of us, but we decided to team up and expedite our research together in high-profile journals. And this, of course, accelerated the acceptance of the manuscripts and allowed a better sharing and dissemination of the results. I am also very thankful to CIRE Foundation, as well as the Ministry of Health Affairs, that really supported this this research, and finally the European Research Council that allocated finally the 10 million euros that allowed to do this breakthrough that I will summarize quickly. So our field in 2011, our field was revolutionized by the advent of what we call immune checkpoint blockade, which is the manufacturing of antibodies that neutralize what we call the inhibitory receptor expressed on lymphocytes. So when you treat patients with these antibodies, anti-PD-1, anti-CTLA-4, the lymphocytes are unleashed, and they represent a defense mechanism to eradicate cancer cells. So in other words, when patients bearing cancer receive these antibodies, their immune system will fight against their cancer. And so more than 7 different monoclonal antibodies of this kind were approved, FDA or EMA approved, across that many indications, more than 21, and different countries. However, only 30% of patients are really benefiting from these therapies, and we are left over with 70% of resistance. So the immune system of a person, so the duration, the threshold, the intensity, is governed by a variety of different factors stemming from genetics of the host and the cancer, but also co-medication, comorbidities. Today I will introduce that environmental factors, but mainly the microbiota that we have in our mucosa is actually playing a critical role to modulate the immune tonus, the immune system of a given individual. So these are my lips onto a blood jellos. I am not dangerous, but just to tell you that you have to acknowledge that we are a meta-organism in which our mammalian part has co-evolved for millennia in mutualistic symbiosis together with thousands of different bacteria species, but also phages, viruses, parasites, fungi, archaea, nanoarchaea, candidate phyla radiation, and so on. So all these different bugs are lining up onto a 200 square meter intestinal surface, separated by the inner milieu of only 20 micrometer, to exert seminal functions. Of course, absorption of nutrients, metabolism, peristaltism, elimination of pathogens and xenobiotics, but more importantly, the equilibrium, the fitness of the intestinal barrier, and the maturation of our immune system for a full-blown fitness of our meta-organism. So now I will enter a little bit more into technical details, but before that I would like to declare my conflicts of interest. So the European Council is actually stimulating us to try to launch biotech companies and file patents. So I have created a biotech company called Everimmune, who aims at developing pre and probiotics against cancer. So four lines of the impact of the gut microbiota on cancer immunomodulation relies on four pillars of evidence. We showed that antibiotics actually mediate immunosuppression and block the efficacy of immunostimulation with immune checkpoint blockade. We also showed that it's possible to humanize the gut of a mouse, so we call that an avatar mouse. And so when this avatar mouse receives the stools from patients, this avatar mouse will be a phenocopy of the behavior of the patient, meaning that if the animal receives a stool from a patient doomed to fail therapy, this animal will also be resistant to immunotherapy. And in contrast, if this animal receives the stools from a patient prone to respond to immune checkpoint inhibitors, then the animal will respond. And this is a quick but very useful way to predict if a given patient will respond or be resistant to immunotherapy. We also showed that the taxonomic composition of the microbes in our gut will actually predict the propensity of a patient to respond or to be resistant to immunotherapy. And finally, as outlined by Dr. Trauner, our colleagues from Israel and Pittsburgh were able to show that you can bypass, circumvent the primary resistance of melanoma patients to immunotherapy by just providing allogeneic, so new stools from other individuals that were cured from their disease. So I just, for those of you who are quite familiar with this curve, so these are Kaplan-Meier survival curves, and we can appreciate that those patients that took antibiotics will rapidly relapse compared with the others. And this was not only showed in lung cancer patients, but also in kidney cancer patients. So antibiotics are not good and will pave the way to resistance to immunotherapy, specifically when these antibiotics are taken 1 month prior to the start of immunotherapy. And so antibiotics are really reshuffling the composition of the gut microbiota, and we can monitor that by metagenomics. So the avatar mouse model is actually what I was telling to you. You just replace the gut normal stools by human stools, and you can see that the responders, mice, will be those that have received the poops of a responding patient. And in contrast, the non-responders have received the fecal material of somebody who didn't respond to immunotherapy. And so, thanks to an enormous network in France of experts in lung cancer, but also in kidney cancer, and also together with the European Council allocation, this time I was successful, we got all the experts in Europe to try to identify whether cancer patients have a different metagenomic composition, and whether this different metagenomic composition would actually dictate, govern the clinical outcome of a patient during therapies against cancer. Without the C-Ray Foundation, we wouldn't have been able to link the metagenomic composition, so the setup, the repertoire of the bacteria we have in the gut, together with the metabolism and the nutrition. So the axis nutrition, metabolism, and digestive tract commensalism has been supported by the C-Ray Foundation. So to make it short, because it's kind of complex, here we have first compared the composition of the gut commensalism in healthy volunteers, more than 5,000, with that of cancer patients. And we found abnormalities, meaning that there was an over-representation in red here of species that are normally not found in healthy volunteers at the expense of the good ones in blue there. But what was striking is that when we compared the responders from the non-responders, so looking at the metagenomics composition of the gut microbiota, we find again these bad guys, so the commensals that are over-dominant, over-represented in the intestine of non-responders and in cancer patients, at the expense of the right one. So at the early step, we didn't know exactly why the cancer patients had this dysbiosis. We call that a gut dysbiosis. And this gut dysbiosis actually is not specific of cancer. Any kind of chronic inflammation, neurological inflammation, inflammatory bowel disease, cardiovascular failure, all of these pathophysiological disorders are actually sensed by the ileum, and this triggers this intestinal dysbiosis made of these bad guys at the expense of the good guys. And so why are patients showing up with this disorder at the level of their gut composition? And we found out that cancer is actually sensed by the ileum, not by the colon, by the ileum. The ileum is a terminal part of the small intestine, and the ileum is full of immune system, and it is also very much innervated. And so we found that cancer is sensed by the ileum through a disequilibrium, a disbalance between cholinergic and sympathetic signaling. And this creates a stress. I will detail a little bit for those of you who are pathologists. I know that we have some pathologists here today. And this is actually damaging the barrier of the intestine, and consequently, the bacteria are unhappy and they will fight, and some good bacteria will be eliminated and the opportunistic ones will survive. And this will be a protracted dysbiosis that actually is immunosuppressive, prevent the patients from responding to immunostimulation. And so this is a kind of colorful, but it explained to you that when a cancer is growing, even distal from the gut, this cancer is actually promoting the abrasion, so an ileal atrophy of the villi, and this is caused by apoptosis of the crypt of the villi, and the crypt lengths are completely reshuffled. There is also the secretory component of the gut, so the Paneth cells degranulate, the neuroendocrine cells ectopically proliferate, and then we have a vasoconstriction of the vessels, and then the nerves start being completely dysregulated with this battle leading to an over sympathetic signaling. And this paves the way to the outgrowth of this enterocluster, the genus enterocluster, the bad guys I was telling to you a while ago. But this is not neutral, because what happens is that you can show that this gut dysbiosis promotes tumor outgrowth. If you treat the animals with antibiotics, you kill this enterocluster genus, which is the opportunistic group of bacteria, and in that case, you can, this gram-positive elimination will decrease tumor severity and aggressiveness. So to make it short, we were able to identify the captain of the group, the captain of the lady, the crown, the governor of the whole commensalism. We believe that Akkermansia is one of the most important bacterium, an anaerobic bacterium, normally known to control the maintenance of the insulin receptors and struggling against insulinoresistance, being also a prevention against obesity. And so in lung cancer patients, we found that the level and the relative representativity of Akkermansia in three groups will dictate the overall survival of patients. So those that have Akkermansia in the gut at normal levels will be those patients that do not relapse so much. In sharp contrast, those patients that are negative for Akkermansia or that have too much of Akkermansia in dark blue, because Akkermansia is struggling and proliferating to compensate for a damage in the gut, are those that are relapsing very, very fast. So we could mimic that in mice, meaning that if you transfer in mice poops that are devoid of Akkermansia, then the mice resist to immunotherapy unless you compensate with an exogenous administration of a lyophilized Akkermansia. So we are now we are launching and conducting a clinical trial at Gustave Roussy, selecting patients that are Akkermansia negative and treating them with a lyophilized version of encapsulated Akkermansia. So how come that the little bugs that are in our gut can control the tumor immunosurveillance even in tumors that are expanding at a distal site, so extra-intestinal tumors? And actually, you have to keep in mind that these trillions of microbes are actually containing in their genomes antigens that can be molecular mimic of cancer antigens. And this, we published that 2 years ago. An enterophage, so a Sifoviridae phage, it's a virus of a bacteria. This phage can lysogenize, so penetrate into the DNA of the bacteria, conferring to this bacteria an antigenicity, so that the antigens elicit T lymphocytes that will come back to the cancer and recognize a molecular mimic of the phage, which is an oncogene, and this will promote tumor regression. Bacteria also are a source of ligands of pattern recognition receptors, which have been, of course, identified as being very important adjuvant for immunity. Bacteria also provide metabolites. We have the L-arginine, the short-chain fatty acid, the polyamines. All of these are good metabolites that can also activate some effector lymphocytes. We also know that this lining of bacteria, with their close interaction with the epithelial barrier, modulate the seminal function, the biological functions like the ER stress response, the autophagic machinery. All of those are so crucial for maintaining the fitness of the body. And we also now, and this is a science paper that we just got accepted last week, we now are coming with the importance of the mucosal adresin MADCAM in the intestine. In fact, I told you at the beginning of this talk that antibiotics were immunosuppressive. They would dampen the efficacy of immunostimulation. And we showed that it's because antibiotics, when you stop antibiotics, you have this genus enterocluster, so the opportunistic bacteria that take over, And these opportunistic bacteria, they downregulate the mucosal MADCAM, which is the scotch of the intestinal barrier vasculature. And this molecule is actually binding to a receptor called alpha 4 beta 7. It keeps the regulatory T cells in the gut. And these regulatory T cells are so important to tolerate food antigens and bacterial antigens. So the pool of regulatory T cells has to be maintained in the intestine for our tolerance. And this pool of T-regs, in the absence of MADCAM, will go into cancer. And regulatory T cells, tolerance against cancer is of course very bad, because it prevents the host from struggling against tumorigenesis. So just to illustrate for the gastroenterologists in this room, and I know that there are plenty of them, that soluble MADCAM is a proxy of ileal MADCAM. So we can monitor by ELISA the levels of soluble MADCAM in the serum. And those patients that have low soluble MADCAM have a very poor prognosis. The same in this validation cohort. And we also showed that it's not only true for lung cancer patients, but can be extrapolated and validated in kidney cancer and bladder cancer patients. So we believe that this is a new surrogate marker for gut dysbiosis. And this has to be monitored in the future among all the parameters dictating the failure to immunotherapy. And this is in multivariate analysis, this parameter was completely independent. So I had to finish, or at least to tell you that we are not sterile. In the textbook of immunology, our mentors have taught us that we are supposed to be sterile everywhere. In actual fact, it's wrong. It's because our technologies and cultural mix methodologies were unable to detect the very small particles. But now we know that tumors are full of microbes, specifically brain tumors, but also breast cancers, without mentioning, of course, colorectal cancers and so on. And we know that these microbes now, they maintain a sustained proliferative signaling. They are pro-inflammatory. They are anti-apoptotic. And they promote escape from immunosurveillance. So you have heard about Helicobacter pylori for the stomach cancer, and now Fusobacterium nucleatum for colorectal cancers and others. So actually, there is a good face of this genus, which is that in some instances, the bacteria can be good guys for us. And we recently published a work in bladder cancer, in stage 3 bladder cancers, amenable to a neoadjuvant treatment with immune checkpoint inhibitors, that those patients that will respond to the immunotherapy and bearing these locally advanced bladder tumors are actually infected with E. coli, Escherichia coli. So Escherichia coli can invade the tumoral urothelium. And by doing so, we can visualize this E. coli by electron microscopy, by scanning electron microscopy, by fluorescent hybridization methodology, by PCR. And what we saw is that when these bacteria are inside the cancer, they are immunogenic. So the immune system is shaped, is educated by these bacteria. And this immune system has a receptor to respond to immunotherapy. So suddenly the patient becomes an outstanding responder. And so once again here, what we did is that we unveiled the crosstalk between a T cell and a B cell. We call that a tertiary lymphoid structure. And this T cell and B cell crosstalk is actually leading to the secretion of immunoglobulin, IgG, against E. coli. And monitoring the titer of IgG against E. coli also predict the outcome of the patient. So in other words, this is an indirect proxy that if you are immunized against your own bacteria that in fact infect your own tumor, the immunotherapy will just reinstate what was there in the first place. So now the very question is, can pasteurized E. coli replace BCG, Bacille Calmette-Guérin, that we were using, but it's very hard to have now the batches of BCG from the industrial partners. So we would replace BCG by E. coli, and this would be the next revolution, I suspect. So now, where are we standing in terms of clinical implementation? So at the moment, investigators are conducting several trials aimed at using the gold poops. So the very healthy individuals can donate their material, their fecal material, to save other people. And this is in the hands of biotech company at the moment. We also envision to use the metabolites of the good microbes, such as the freed oxybutyrate, the spermidine, and so on. We also contemplate to use the queen of the gut, so Akkermansia, but also the other probiotics that have anti-cancer functions. We also think about complementing this with specific diets that mediate their function through metabolic reshuffling, like fasting, like fiber-enriched diet, like ketogenic diet. And so this is two illustrations. These are two illustrations of the first pioneering studies that Dr. Trauner was referring to, showing that one third of individuals that received allogeneic poops from a donor could actually suddenly respond to immunotherapy while they were resistant at the first place. So it is amazing to see that the two different locations, the two different universities across the world were able to show the same things on 36 patients. And when the allogeneic poops are transferred to a given individual, of course, many other functions are reshuffled, reshaped, reprogrammed. So we change the metabolism, we change the immune tonus, we decrease the peripheral inflammation, and of course, at the prime site, we have remodeled the good guys and the bad guys in the gut. We have eliminated the enterocluster genus for the benefit of the other more immunostimulatory bugs. Also, at the west coast of the United States, together with Monty Pal, a study in kidney cancer, metastatic kidney cancer, showed the proof of concept that the combination of two immune checkpoint inhibitors, together with this probiotic, a Japanese probiotic, Clostridium butyricum, would actually synergize. So this probiotic would actually synergize with the immune checkpoint inhibitors. And this was a randomized study, so this this trial has to be, of course, repeated, but it offers a new prospect. So ketogenic diet is actually interesting because when you feed mice with less than 4 grams of glucose per day, and you have a fat-enriched and protein-enriched diet, the immune tonus of the mice change, and you can get an immunostimulation, a low PD-L1 expression on antigen-presenting cells, and this will synergize with immune checkpoint blockade. And our colleagues at the MD Anderson were able to show that patients that take probiotics, the wrong probiotics, they will have a shift in their microbiota. And if they take low fibers, or if they take fibers but with probiotics, they will be prone to or doomed to fail the therapy. So definitely, you are what you eat, and the composition of the microbes will actually dictate, in turn, not only the metabolism, but the tonus of the immune system, and finally, the tumor microenvironment and the resistance to immunotherapy. So I would like to finish with this illustration from Canada, from one of my alumni, Bertrand Routy. So he was very intrigued by the properties allegated by the Brazilians. So they claim that the Brazilian berry, Camu Camu, is very good for health. So he tried in mice. He fed the mice with Camu Camu together with immune checkpoint inhibition in tumor bearers, and he showed that there was a very nice synergistic effect. And then when he looked at the composition, the taxonomic composition of the feces of these mice, he showed a shift towards Acermantia mucinifila and the good ruminococci. But then when he did this mass spectroscopy to identify the components that are inside the camu-camu, he saw an enrichment for a polyphenol called castalagin. And castalagin could completely phenocopy the effect of camu-camu. But with using a fluorescent castalagin, he could show that the ruminococcus in the gut became green. So meaning that when you feed, we are fed with polyphenol, the polyphenol are promoting the proliferation and the dominance of certain bugs that you have in the gut. And those will take the stage and eliminate or prevent the opportunistic bacteria for existing. And so, at the end of the road, we would like to propose to stratify the patient's population based on. So, first of all, we would like to stop overlooking the power of the gut. And as soon as we have a patient coming into the clinic to be immunostimulated, we would like first to check whether this person has all the criteria to fail the therapy, for instance, taking antibiotics or proton pump inhibitors or laxatives that will reshuffle the composition of the commensals. Then we will look by a quick shotgun metagenomics analysis at the composition of the bacteria. And according to what we will find, moderate, severe dysbiosis, we could propose some kind of compensatory strategy before we start to launch the immunostimulation so that we rebuild the homeostasis that was lost in this individual. And of course, we need careful and rigorous pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics translational studies to be able to monitor what we are doing. So at Gustave Roussy, that's what we are actually conducting at the moment. We have all these clinical trials open, and we also launch this polyomics investigation in a given patient to make sure that we don't lose the tracks between the interaction of all the different factors that dictate the fitness of the body. And I would like to finish by showing to you again the CIRE Foundation that had the vision to link the crosstalk between the host and the bugs. And also my two young investigators, Lisa De Rosa and Bertrand Routy, who won many awards from the American Society of Clinical Oncology and the European Society of Medical Oncology for all this work that they initiated courageously together with the rest of the team. So this is the team currently, and we are showing the octopus, so it's not just the mascot of the lab, but it's just to illustrate that each arm of the octopus consists in one parameter of the fitness of your body: immunology, metabolism, metagenomic, proteomic, bone marrow hematopoiesis, and so on, and that we are a meta-organism where everything is connected, and we just need to understand that a cancer is not just an amount of cells growing in one side of the body, but it's already a failure of the whole homeostasis. So I would like to thank the very faithful and supportive expert in oncology, in metagenomics, in culturomics, and the network of the European Council, and my new postdoc that you can recognize, Emmanuel Macron, that visited us. Thank you very much.
We have now the big honor to honor you with the
gold medal and the certificate and, of course, a lot of flowers. So thanks
thank
a lot for giving
much.
This extraordinary
thank
lecture.
You very much.
I do think all of us appreciate very much. So
thank you very much.
Let's start. So
oh, wonderful. Oh.
Now we need the photos.
Oh,
please
I
come.
Love it. I love it.
Thank you very much. It's really moving for me a lot, honestly. I try to keep my cries, but now I cannot anymore.
Thanks a lot.
Congratulations.